Everyone to accept my invitation to join this round table discussing Erdogan's work. We learned a lot from him, from his studies, his theoretical and methodological approach crafting history of Iran in 19th and 20th century. Let me, because if we don't have much time and there are many colleagues and friends they want to talk about Erdogan's work, let me not say more and leave them to say, and I add my words at the end. On the organization of this roundtable, we agreed that each panelist has 5 to 7 minutes to talk about Erdogan's work. And then after that, we go for 10 minutes response from Erdogan to all these comments. And then we stop and we go to the audience. If you've got some comments, questions, you can. Not more than 2 minutes, we don't have much time. And then finally we come back to Erdogan to have his final response. So, the order is, we agreed that the first one, first talk goes to my friend Val, and Val talks about contribution of Erdogan to Iranian studies. And then I go to Mohammad Tavakkali Tarab. He talks about the historiography of historiographical contribution by comparing the studies of the crowds in the Constitution and 1978-79 revolution. That followed by Kaveh Ehsani's talk about 1978-79 revolution in Abrahamian's work. We have Afshin and Metin Askeri's Islamic movement in Erdogan's work. Then Mirzad Burujerdi, Qajar and Pahlavi intellectuals' trends in Erdogan's work. We have Azadeh Kian, gender dimension in Erdogan's work. Maziar Behrouz, to the party coup d'etat of 1953 in Erdogan's book. And finally, is my turn talking about workers and laboring poor in Erdogan's work. Okay? So I would like me to ask my friend Val to come here. Please, yes. Please, 5 to 6, 7 minutes.
Got it. All right. Thank you so much, Tunaj, for this kind invitation. It's really a pleasure and a privilege for me to be able to share my thoughts about Erdogan's work. The book, Iran Between Two Revolutions, is an outstanding study that had a tremendous influence on me, as on many others. The mastery over Iranian history is eminently evident, but it's also a kind of alternative presentation, a little like Howard Zinn's People's History of the United States, although with less of the emotive language. In particular, I appreciated the focus on the left, which showed the important role played by the Tudeh Party and the Fedayeen Demokrat in national and regional politics. 3 out of the 11 chapters are devoted to a rich analysis of the Tudeh Party, its social bases, and its political activities. Given that the Cold War was still on when Abrahamian was writing, this new narrative was both refreshing and highly instructive of the possibilities for a modern developmentalist state that could have emerged in Iran had things turned out differently in the 1950s, not to mention 1979. I was returning and rereading the book in 2011 as I was writing a paper on revolutions, hegemons, and prospects for democratization after the Arab Spring. And the book really inspired me to think again about the way that Iran had been integrated into the capitalist world economy at that time with Britain as the hegemon, as a peripheral extractive economy. And you know, one may infer, as I do, that first the 1953 coup d'etat and then the Islamic Revolution prevented Iran's rapid ascension to, you know, what world systems people call the semi-periphery, and it also stalled movements for democratization and for Iran's capacity to join democracy's third wave. So the politics of oil that Abrahamian describes so well, the Shah's dictatorship, and then the new hegemon America's support for the Shah's dictatorship, and the institutional setup of the Islamic Republic, all have constituted blocks on these types of developments, on Iran's capacity to become one of the major semi-peripheral countries, as well as its democratizing capacity. I find that Abrahamian's work on the 1953 coup d'etat to remain seminal, though I realize that it is not without controversy and challenges. He shows the salience of both internal and external factors and forces in the shaping of Iran's political history, including, of course, the politics of oil. He's very critical of the role of Britain and the USA, as some of us in this room are, and a little bit more ambiguous about the role of the Soviet Union, as some of us here are as well. And against the claims that the USA was neutral in the negotiations between Britain and Iran, Abrahamian shows that the US had its own imperial ambitions. Quite true. I realize that there are challenges to his argument that the origin of the Azerbaijan crisis was largely a Western bid for control over Iran's oil. Abrahamian has tended to downplay the ideological side of the US-Soviet contention in favor of an economic argument. But as Althusser would say, crises are overdetermined, multiple contradictions are at play, and ideological forces must be taken into account. Domestic actors are not puppets, they have agency and make strategic choices in line with their own perceived interests. In the case of both the Azerbaijan and the oil nationalization crises, economic interests and ideological affiliations alike, what Marxists broadly call class interests, were certainly at play. I should add that I was brought up admiring both the Tudeh Party and the Fedre Demokrat, mainly because my late father had joined the Azerbaijan Autonomous Republic's project as a young man, just after his return home following graduation from the Donshkari Fani. So you might say that I was already somewhat inclined to accept Abrahamian's more positive analysis, while also benefiting from the empirical evidence that he marshals. You know, many years later, and I think that perhaps Tudaj is going to talk a little bit more about this, but many years later, my late father was very saddened by the books, the kind of revisionist historiography of Azerbaijan that his former boss, Jahan Shahlu, wrote, called Mova Begonigon, which was essentially an indictment of the Fedre Demokrat, the Tudeh Party, the Soviet Union, and the only kind words that he has is for Pishevadi himself. So as one who's been steeped in Marxist and the socialist tradition, I continue to be impressed with Abrahamian's class analysis, which is nuanced as well as empirically rich. His discussion of the intelligentsia, the modern middle class, the modern working class, was at the time unprecedented, although I was always aware of other studies on the working class, Willem Floor and others. As a political sociologist, I was especially impressed by Abrahamian's emphasis, and I continue to be so, on the interaction between political organizations and social forces. So here was a study that came out just after the Iranian Revolution, when all manner of studies were focused on the role of religious ideology and the clerical caste, and there was a kind of a retroactive reading back of Islam and clerics through Iranian history. But his book, in fact, drew attention to the emergence of modern social forces and modern institutions. But I think there's just one deficit in the book. And I think that Azadeh is going to speak perhaps more on the gender issue, but all I want to say is that this is hardly his fault, given the era in which he was writing. As I've said, as political history, it is absolutely superb. But as social history, it leaves out any information on what women of the various social classes were doing in the various areas that the book covers. This gap, which is found in many more recent historical and sociological studies as well, is what prompted me to write my essay, Hidden from History, at the invitation of Turaj, which came out in Iranian Studies in the year 2000. So let me end by noting that in a recent roundtable in IJMIS, the International Journal of Middle East Studies, Cyrus Shoaib writes of the virtual disappearance of the categories such as class and peasant from Middle East history. And he writes that cultural history has replaced social history. This may be true, but what is equally true is that Abrahamian's book, which echoes the works of British Marxist historians such as E.P. Thompson and Eric Hobsbawm, will continue to inspire and be the standard reference book for the period he covers, certainly for scholars like myself. Thank you, and thank you, Ervan.
I'll make it short. Professor Abrahamian has been a source of inspiration for me since my graduate years at the University of Chicago. His book, Iran Between the Two Revolutions, was really the guide for me for the writing of a dissertation that was a comparison of the Iranian Constitutional Revolution, 1905-1909, and what became the Islamic Revolution. And in fact, much of the theoretical endeavors, historiographical endeavors that I had was through a dialogue with Abrahamian's really immensely rich work. What one of the things that caught my attention from the very beginning was how the work of Abrahamian differs from a lot of other people in the field of Iranian studies, and what was distinctive about it was his commitment to historical methodology, that he was citing extensively, and this is one thing that you don't see in a whole lot of other readings. He reads diverse sources and brings those diverse sources into the dialogue. For example, the part of the book on Iran Between Two Revolutions, about 1940s, the dialogue, the contestation that happens is immense. And the sources, wide range of sources that he introduces, exceptional, I would say. What also is distinctive about the work of Abrahamian is that he doesn't theorize. He historicizes, but that historicization is in dialogue with prominent historians of his own time. For example, when he died, a number of seminal articles that he has, I think my favorite really increasingly has become an article that he wrote in 1968, The Crowd in Iranian Revolution, that was published in the prominent Journal of Past and Present in 1968, is in a rich dialogue with George Roudet's writing on the crowd in the French Revolution, the European history. And what is interesting, again, unlike the tradition of Orientalist historiography that takes models and imposes it on Iran, he brings to life the diversity of crowd in Iran, pays attention to specificities of the crowd, for example, focusing on the Iranian Constitutional Revolution in this article, he looks at various guilds that are participants in the revolution, various merchants that are involved, and the linkage that Bazaar has with the clerics, and then notes that the crowd plays a very important role in determining the shape of politics because it intervenes at the moment, a decisive moment that brings about a shift. So in contradistinction to the conception of the crowd as irrational, as a mob, he comes up with an account of Iranian crowd that is very rational, calculating, and intervenes at those conjunctural moments to bring about positive, more democratizing, often changes. And this article that I mentioned, the Past and Present, from 1905 to 1953, then he follows it with another article on the crowd in the Iranian Revolution, offers a really rich chronology of Iranian revolution and the changing nature of the participation of various sectors of the society in the revolution. The first article that I mentioned, The Crowd of the Iranian Revolution, it's probably one of the best concise presentation of the Iranian Constitutional Revolution. If you have graduate students who want to become familiar with the Iranian Constitutional Revolution and read the first five, six pages of that, it does that. The Crowd of the Iranian Revolution also is a rich, concise, highly informed reading of the Iranian Revolution and how it shifts from people that he quotes as lads, as youngsters, high school and university students, to increasing presence of the crowd, and how ideology of the crowd and politics of the crowd changes and transforms the Iranian Revolution into an Islamic revolution. In addition to this two articles that I mentioned, again, distinctive in its historiographical methodology is the 1953 coup in Iran, which has appeared as a book, but I continue to love the article version of it, in which appeared in Science and Society in 2001, highly concise. And all of these articles, in a sense, what I want to say is what is distinctive about the work of Avrahamyan is not only that he has big books, important books, but he has seminal articles that focus on particular problems, brings a variety of views, perceptions, analyticals, and puts them into dialogue with one another, and then he offers an enduring historical account. And for that, I'm really grateful to you, because I use his books and articles for various seminars that I have, and my graduate students often use his as the very first sources to go to. Thank you.
Well, it's an honor to be here and to kind of celebrate the work of Ermand Avrahamyan. You know, I started reading Ermand's work in the late 1970s. What was really important and striking to me was that not only was a foremost historian of 20th century Iran, but he was also writing as a public intellectual. He was writing about contemporary events, the Iranian Revolution. His essays, especially in Merv, were kind of groundbreaking and offering a different perspective from the Iranian Revolution, about the Iranian Revolution, from a lot of what was coming out at the time. And if you recall, much of the discourse about the Iranian Revolution was really kind of trapped into a framing of the revolution within notions of Shiism, Islamic fundamentalism, Islamism, or a kind of a battle between a very abstract version of modernity and modernization versus an equally abstract and I would say vapid notion of traditionalism. And Ermand basically wrote a series of very important and insightful articles looking at the Iranian Revolution that came out in Mehr. That basically began to look or present the Iranian Revolution in materialist and in sociological and Marxian terms, and that was actually quite liberating. And if you look at any anthology of the writings about the Iranian Revolution, Ermand's essays are always listed in there and are part of it, which an important part of it. For me, this was very meaningful, because later on I stepped into Ermand's quite large boots at Merv, you know, becoming an editor of Merv myself, and I was very proud always of being part of the tradition of writing about Iran that Ermand Avrahamyan had established. Now, I want to talk about two, and like Mamat, like one of his essays, but also one of his books. The essay that really kind of struck me and had an important impact on me, even though I kind of began to distance myself from his perception and look at it very differently, was his classic essay on the non-revolutionary peasantry of modern Iran, co-authored with Farhad Kazim. This is a very important essay that basically looks at important political movements in Iran, the Janghali movement, the Azerbaijan, the oil nationalization, and basically sees an absence of the peasantry as a social agent in the process. Now, in the 1990s, right after the Iran-Iraq War, I went to Iran, to Khuzestan, to do my field work on the peasants and their participation in the revolution and the war. And I basically came back really kind of disagreeing with the way that Ervand and Farhad Kazemi had kind of framed the role of the peasantry in the politics of modern Iran. And I've written about this extensively. But the point is that you need a framework to disagree with, to basically allow you to see things that then you can distance yourself and say, all right, this is one way of looking at it, whether the peasants were an active agent and part of important moments of political activism, or if you're on the ground doing ethnography and looking at you know, how the rural world and the rural actors are kind of melded into and embedded in larger political movements and the life of the nation state, can you see it differently? Can you offer alternative explanations? And you need basically solid, coherent arguments to kind of set yourself against and engage in a dialogue with to say that no, there is, you know, there are different ways of seeing it. The second body of Ervand's work that I think is really important and influential is his work, his book that came out in 1993, which was more or less a continuation of what the essays he had written in Merv, and it was called Khomeinism. Now, you know, Raymond Williams talks about keywords. He says there are always keywords that we kind of organize our understanding of the world around these keywords. And some are really not that controversial. You know, a baobab tree is something we can all agree on. And then there are other keywords that we all think we kind of agree on, but are very contentious. They have a history, they have depth and thickness to them, and we kind of organize the world differently, but come into friction because we have very different understandings of them. And one of these keywords is, in the course of the Iranian Revolution, has been the whole place of religion, Islam, and the role of Ayatollah Khomeini in the process. You know, what was the nature of the revolution? The book that Ervand wrote, Khomeinism, actually offered a new keyword that allowed us to kind of distanciate ourselves from those other words, keywords, that had really come to monopolize and hegemonize our understanding of what had happened in Iran in 1978. And those words were fundamentalism, Islamism, you know, the unique focus on Shiism as if though by itself an ideological movement had transformed and mobilized the entire population. Now, Ervand's work offered a very different reading without dismissing the role of religion, but he looked at the Iranian Revolution as a populist movement. He looked at perceptions of property, society, and the state within the practices and the discourses and the lawmaking of the revolution. He looked at rituals such as May Day, how they were kind of unfolding and how the Islamists were kind of taking over, you know, these rituals that had a root in very different traditions, and how the history was being written and how in a paranoid way the history of post-revolution was being written. It was a liberating book because it really allowed us to use a new keyword, Khomeinism, to realize, okay, what is the role of the personality of Khomeini, the charismatic individual's role in politics and in shaping society, but also that, you know, this is a, you know, what happened in Iran was a political movement, very much of the modern world, very much tied to the politicization of religion, but not limited to it and not reduced to it. So for that new keyword, I want to thank Ervand, and I think it's an honor for me to to be here and to kind of discuss his work. Thank you.
Okay, I try to also be within the 5-6 minutes, and it helps because some of us are kind of repeating some observations. But I just had one observation that just jumped to my head, and that is this session looks like, and I think it really is, a welcome back to Iranian studies for Abrahamian, who at some point kind of left. That's also maybe something to talk about. And now he's back, and his presentations include three presidents, at least of Iranian studies, past, present, and future, who have been, well, I don't know, they can speak for themselves, but not, well, I don't want to use the word disciple, you're going to disagree with me, but in some ways, very much like students, I would say, and they all come from the same kind of political background. I don't think I'm divulging information, that's one of the things I do in my research, but that I appreciated Abrahamian's work, and now he's back here, and with all the whatever issues of Iranian studies, there's something strange that these three presidents are all in some ways, or at least part of their life, in the Abrahamian school of understanding modern Iranian history. Now, quickly to some of my own points, my task was to say a few things about Abrahamian's approach to Islamic movements and studies, and people talked about Iran between two revolutions, so I'm not going to repeat that. That it was a paradigm shift. It was a breakthrough, especially for those of us. It came out, of course, exactly in 1982. It was the first major book that put the left and a revolutionary reading of Iranian history front and center, and right. It was obviously, it started before the revolution, but it came out after the revolution. I'm going to say something about the problem that caused, but it was like the Quran of many of us who tried to understand what the heck was Iranian history that caused this revolution that just happened. Now, let me just say a word about the twist. The ironic twist of Iran between two revolutions was that it was paradoxically a chronicle of the secular left's contribution to Iranian history, but then it ended with an Islamic revolution. So, and that was something that Abrahamian had to deal with later, because if you look at Iran between the revolutions, to show that I've done some careful research, I went and checked the page numbers, and it's 537 pages, at least the edition I have, and 500 pages of it don't get to the second revolution, the Islamic revolution. The build-up to it is there, but the chapter on the second revolution takes only 37 out of 537 pages, and 30 pages of those are, again, rather descriptive, a very good blow-by-blow description of the revolution's unfolding. There's a 7-page analytical conclusion. And so there's something missing, the riddle, the paradox of it, and he calls it a paradox. That has to be done later. And Abrahamian gets to that in the Iranian Mujahideen that comes out in 1989, and he goes back to what Iran between two revolutions had not done. I just quickly, parenthetically, since people talked about his articles, he has a very interesting breakthrough article on Kasravi. And in that, he also notes in passing that Kasravi's conception of religion was also this kind of Durkheimian influence, perhaps through Zia Gokalp, that religion is kind of a glue that holds a society and a nation together, and that was more Kasravi's understanding of the religion he was advocating, was something along those lines. So he was cognizant of that before, but that was not his focus. Iranian Mujahideen then is amazingly closely source-based, not what should it blows you away when you read these works of the Mujahideen organization. It's a work of a much smaller scale, but more sharply focus, and it remained the only academic study of Iran's guerrilla movement until Peyman Bahabzadeh was here, and he was supposed to be on that panel. I don't know, maybe too many of us, so Peyman, I guess you were kind of short-shifted up, but maybe you can say something during the conversation. No one did any work on that, but he did it, and he focused then appropriately on the Islamic